The Philippine Stock Exchange saw higher trading activity during the first half of the year. Daily average value turnover was at 8.96 billion pesos, up by 21.9% year-to-date and 35.9% year-on-year. PSE President Ramon Monzon believes the stock market can return to pre-pandemic levels in the near term if the government meets its COVID vaccination targets by the end of 2021. But just recently, Philippine shares suffered their biggest single-day drop since April after Fitch Ratings revised its outlook for the economy from stable to negative. Is this a sign of more hurdles ahead for the local bourse? Joining us for his take is Alvin Arogo, PNB's head of research. During the first half of the year, can you give us some of the highlights in the stock market? Like, what are some of the themes that we saw in the first half?
You know, the market was down by around 3% year to end June and closed at the 6.9 level. And it would seem that it was a boring first half, but definitely the snapshot of that performance masks the volatility that was seen during the period. So I think it's worthwhile if we look at the month-on-month movements and identify what were the biggest market drivers. But first of all, we have to recall that equity investors enjoyed the three-month rally as they welcome 2021. With the PSEI rising by about 22% quarter on quarter to end 2020 at the 7140 level. No? This was driven mainly by the optimism with the announcement of the Pfizer biotech vaccine that was announced in November. So I think the first monthly move, which was a 7% drop in January, can be attributed primarily to profit-taking. And then the ensuing bargain-hunting opportunity following January resulted in a 3% bounce in Feb. No? Thereafter, the PSEI lost 5% in March and 1% in April. And I think this is mainly due to the second wave of COVID-19 infections in the Philippines, as well as the slow rollout of vaccinations. No? We have to recall that the seven-day moving average rose sharply from about 2,200 per day at the end of Feb to over 10,000 in March and April. And as a consequence, there were stricter pandemic curves and the impact on the economy was swift. For example, the unemployment rose to 8.7% in April from the 7.1% print prior to the reimposition of the harsher measures. For the vaccination, there was hope, but the delivery was slow with only 0.3% of the population getting the full dose and about 1.5% of Filipinos having at least one dose. And then we also had the problem with inflation. At that time, it became more apparent to market participants that inflation will stay above the 4% level. And indeed, from January to April, inflation had an average of 4.5%. Now, that slide continued for the most part in May, amid the release of the first quarter GDP data, which showed that recession continued for the fifth straight quarter. But the market fortunately found support near the 6.2 level towards end May. And it is interesting to note that the PE at that point was near the 15-year average of 7.3 times. Now, starting the last week of May, risk on sentiment returned due to the positive developments regarding the three key issues that I said hounded the market in March and April. Consequently, the PSEI rallied by 4% in May and 4.1% in June.
So the market is down in the first half, but We saw an increase in value turnover during the first half relative to last year and also relative to the second half of last year. So, what is the reason for this happening despite the weak performance of the market?
A couple of reasons, no? I think number one is even though the market was down in the first half, if you dissect the monthly performance, no, there were both profit-taking opportunities as well as opportunities to realize capital gains, no? So I think that contributed to the higher value turnover because the first half performance, although it was down by 3%, within the month, no, if you churn your trades, there's actually an opportunity to gain. Second is we saw a couple of big IPOs like Mondelēz and DD REIT, no? So I think that added to the volume of the market.
What about foreign investors? They were actually quite bearish in the first half and they continued to sell the market. Do you think they will come back the second half of the year?
I think they will come back only if there's more stability in the progress of our COVID vaccinations. No, I think within the region, we're one of the laggards. And in addition to that, there is going to be an election next year, no, which creates another uncertainty. So for the second half of this year, I think foreign investors will definitely be turned off, no, by the higher political uncertainty, which of course comes, no, every time we get into that 6-year election cycle. But it's not completely hopeless. If the pace of vaccinations increase, then I think that will encourage, you know, some foreign funds to come back. And at the same time, the low base, no, starting the second quarter of this year for the GDP means that it is easier to post growth once again. But again, I repeat, no, without the clarity or a confidence regarding the pace of the vaccinations, it will be hard to expect that foreign funds will come.
In the first half, were there sectors that performed strongly or were all sectors performing weakly in the first half of the year?
I think it's more no particular sector, no, but within the sector there have been different performers. But what I can say is that the reopening theme has been fully reflected in consumer discretionary, like restaurants. And I think to some degree, banks have been fairly priced already. But there are other sectors that I believe, no, apart from those two that I mentioned, continue to be mispriced.
So for the second half of the year, what's your outlook? Do you think the market can go up or do you expect us to stay, you know, where we are right now?
Well, our baseline outlook, no, for the PSEI as a whole over the next 6 to 12 months is about 7,490. So based on the close, the last close, that gives an upside of some 12%. That forecast is based on a 20.8 times PE and 35% EPS growth for 2021. And as a baseline, although I don't think herd immunity will be attained this year, I think the hope, no, will be there, and the pace of delivery will be better, no, at least compared to what we saw in the first half. At the same time, I think the yield environment will be relatively low, which means more investors need to look for riskier assets, no, to generate excess returns. And so that should allow, no, for some re-rating in the market multiple. So to me, 7490, no, is a target that can be achieved, but to sustainably get there, we do need to get the foreign funds back, because I feel that if it's just local money churning, I think around 7273, no, is a trigger point for profit taking.
So if you're talking to an investor with, say, a 12-month time horizon, what sectors would you recommend for them to invest in?
If you look at the property sector, I think there are a couple of undervalued stocks, and those that we like have a discount to NAV of about 53% versus our target of about 40%. And so while the pandemic is still a big problem for the real estate companies, I think the current valuation does not fairly capture reopening tailwinds. In contrast, the potential of the economy to move towards the new normal, no, like I alluded a while ago, I think is adequately reflected in most discretionary consumer names. Meanwhile, the resilient and essential consumer companies, which were popular last year, but lost some of their glamour or attractiveness this year, no, I think have been fairly undervalued. Now, for banks, I think most are fairly priced, even though the average price to book for the sector has some, I think, 30% discount to the past five-year average. The challenging NIM and bond investment environment, no, will prevent a return to those higher multiples. Now, for the yield-focused investors, it's the same. I think the power, telco, and REIT space are still the ones to look at, no, for the best options. And finally, on the conglomerates, we're a bit mixed. We see some companies that are undervalued with an average discount to NAV of about 30% compared to our target of 20. But some, I think, are closer to their fair values.
So it seems like, in general, you are quite bullish on the market.
I think we are bullish because if we apply a bottom up analysis, no, there are opportunities to unlock, and at the same time, if we also look at the PE, it would look too high, but at the same time, no, that's because of the earnings plunge caused by the pandemic. But if we look at it on a steady state basis, the price to book of the market is over one standard deviation below its historical average. No, so clearly, I think while we are not yet out of the woods, the bullishness comes from the mispricing.
So with that, thank you very much, Alvin, and stay safe.